turn to page 346. We're going to sing the first, second, and the last verse. How many of you know your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life tonight? Amen. I know mine is, and ain't nothing going to take it out. Amen. I heard preacher Darren Richardson say, you may see me last year and I was saved, and next time you see me, I'm going to be saved. Amen. Let's sing, I Know My Name Is There. Blessing to know that you know that you know that you're saved. Amen. It's good. 1 John chapter number 5 verse 13 says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Amen. I'm glad it's not a hope so, think so, or maybe so, but I'm glad my salvation's a know so. Amen. And Miss Lois, she apologized. She said, I lost it right there. Well, we may lose some stuff down here, but God won't lose me. Amen. He's got me, and I'm sealed by the Holy Spirit of God till the day of redemption. Amen. I just don't say that because it sounds good. I say that because that's what His Word tells me. Amen. And that's why it's good. Amen. If you have your Bibles tonight, turn with me, if you will, to the book of Job, chapter number 17. Book of Job, chapter number 17. I kept you a long time Sunday morning, so I won't try to keep you as long tonight. Maybe I'll do some 10-minute preaching tonight. And all the happy people said, amen. I think I had two or three. And we had a good time Sunday, didn't we? Yeah, that was a good time. That's right. Bring some nabs. Go ahead. Hey, that's all I needed. I'm glad we have liberty in the house of God. Amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. That's what His Word tells us. Book of Job, chapter number 17. If you're there, would you say amen? Amen. I'm going to read one verse of Scripture tonight and preach how the Lord's laid it on my heart. And it's going to be verse number 9. So Job, chapter number 17, verse 9. Job says this, the righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. Let's read it again tonight. It says, the righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. Let's pray tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, Lord, we love you, God. Lord, we just thank you, God, once again, God, for allowing us to gather in your house in your name. And Lord, you promised in your word where two or three are gathered in your name, there you would be in the midst. And Lord, we just pray tonight, Lord, your spirit would have free course tonight. Lord, I pray you bind back any force of hell, Lord, any demon, any devil, any distraction, Lord, that could hinder the word of God from going forth. Lord, I pray you give me clarity of mind. Lord, I just pray, Lord, you give me strength to preach. And Lord, give me understanding of the scriptures. And Lord, I pray tonight, Lord, we would not just be hearers of the word of God, but Lord, we would apply it to our hearts and be doers of your word. And Lord, as we apply this word, just help us just serve you better. And Lord, for everything said and done, we're going to give you honor and glory and praise. And it's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen and amen. Over the past several weeks, or really the past couple of months, we've been looking into the life of Job, and we looked into his character, we looked into his conduct, we looked into his affliction and his worship and stuff like that. And in the past couple of weeks, we've been just going through looking at some sayings throughout the book of Job. And this week, I was a little torn between a few, and one of the ones that kind of popped off in my head was over in chapter number 16. In verse 19, Job said, "Also now, behold, my witness is in heaven." Amen. And I just really wanted to preach on the fact that we have some great things in heaven. Amen. We have a king in heaven. Amen. His name is Jesus. Amen. We have an advocate with the Father, and that is Jesus. Amen. We have our intercessor. He is our daysman. He is our comforter. He is our guide. That's the many things we have in heaven. But the Lord led me to Job chapter number 17, and where we are in the Word of God, we know that for the past several chapters, Job has been in a conversation with his three friends, and they have been coming at Job falsely accusing him, saying that the reason for all the calamity and all the destruction and all the pain and trouble that he is facing in his life is because of a sin that he has committed, and hidden sin in his life, and that God is now bringing it to light. But we know that was not the case, and Job has been defending himself. He has been saying how he has lived righteous, he has lived right before God, that he has did nothing to bring this upon him. But here in Job chapter number 17, you'll find that Job stops appealing to men and he starts appealing unto God. He is speaking unto God now, and he is just pouring out his heart to God, and he is talking to God, and he's saying, "Lord, you know I can't in no way, shape, or form show them that I have been living rightly. Lord, you know that there's no way I can prove, change their minds about what they think." And he's saying, "God, I wish you would just come down and do it for me. Lord, I just wish you just take me on out of here so I wouldn't have to go through this any longer." But here in Job 17, verse 9, while Job is making this appeal to God, he says in verse number 8, he says, "Upright man shall be astonished at this," or that's astonished at this, "and the innocent shall stir up himself against the hypocrite." Now verse 9 says, "The righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger." Amen. Job is saying right here that even though people may look upon him and they may ridicule him and mock him and talk about him, that he hopes that people that know God and love God and live for God will look at the testimony that he's living of how he's remained steadfast, how he's remained faithful, how he has not wavered in his walk, and they will continue on their walk with God as well, no matter if trials come, no matter if troubles come, no matter if afflictions come, that the righteous people will hold their way. And as I was dealing with Job chapter 17, verse 9, I got to reading as if it was almost a proverb. You read it, and it sounds like a proverb. "The righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger." Amen. Many of us know that a proverb is a short saying or a short sentence that offers a general truth or a great piece of advice. And I believe that's what Job delivered right here. And I believe if we would take this verse, if we would take this proverb and we would apply it to our lives, it would help us on our walk with God. And let me just say tonight, I need all the help I can get. Amen. As soon as I think I've made it, as soon as I think I'm strong enough, as soon as I think I have what I need to defeat the devil, that's when I will go down, down, down. Amen. The devil likes us to think that we got it all figured out. The devil likes us to think that we don't need to go to church and hear the word of God because we're making it just fine. And it's because he's scared. Because if a child of God will take the word of God and apply it to their life, they will be able to withstand him and his attempt to take them down. Amen. So let's look into this one verse and see how we can apply it to our lives. Before we really really dig into it, though, we got to look at who is Job talking about. Who is Job exactly talking about in this verse? We see that Job says, the righteous, that is the saved, the redeemed, the justified in the eyes of God. Amen. This is not just merely a churchgoer. This is not merely just a member of the church or another singer in the choir. But whenever you look up that word righteous, it means someone that is justified, that's correspondent to the divine law and applied to people. It is one that is holy in their heart. Amen. It is somebody that is in good standing with God. It is somebody that there is no enmity between them and God. Amen. It is somebody that has sometime in their life heard the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, seen that they were a sinner in need of a Savior, and trusted Him to save them from their sins. And the sad thing about it in today's day and hour is that everybody thinks they're righteous in their own eyes in one way or another. Amen. The book of Proverbs, chapter number 16, verse 2, says, all the ways of a man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirit. So what Solomon is saying, that every man in one way or another thinks that he is in good standing with God. He thinks he's pure. He thinks he's holy. He thinks he's in good standing, but the Lord weighs that man and sees that he is found wanting. Amen. Also in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 30, verse 12, the Bible says, there is a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet is not washed from their filthiness. Amen. So we can see today that there are many people who think they're righteous, but yet they're so far from being righteous. Amen. I want you to remember tonight that everything God has, that the devil has a counterfeit for. God has the righteous and the devil has the religious. Amen. God has the justified and the others wishing they were justified. Amen. We have the power of God, and then there's another crowd that has the form with no power tonight. But who Job is talking about is somebody that has a true relationship with God. They have more than a head knowledge, but they got a heart knowing of who Jesus is. Amen. They were somebody who knew that nothing they could do could get themselves to God, so they trusted in the God that came down to bring them to Him. Amen. And I just want to say tonight that what we need in today's day and hour is a few more righteous people instead of religious people. Amen. We need people that understand what the gospel means. We need people who understand what salvation means in their life. We need people who live by the Word of God and take the Word of God and apply it to their life. I'm afraid today that the day and hour, see, the problem is we've had too many preachers, we've had too many people, we've had too many seminaries, and we've had too many conventions trying to tell people, well, if you're just morally right, then you're righteous. Amen. If you just live good, if you don't drink, if you don't cuss, if you don't party, if you don't sleep around on your spouse, then you'll be all right in the eyes of God and you'll make it into heaven. Friend, I wish that was the case, but none of those things will get you to heaven and keep you out of hell. Amen. There's plenty morally good people that never put cigarettes or joints or beer bottles to their lips. They never sinned against their body. They never cussed. They never did anything immorally bad. But yet, because they trusted in their own righteousness, they found themselves in hell. Amen. That's just as simple as that. There's some that depend on their substance, thinking that they are righteous. Amen. Some people believe if they can just give enough money to the church, if they can just help with the children's program, if they can just help somebody in need, that puts them in good standing with God. But none of that is. Amen. There's other people who think that just because they can put on a suit and put on a tie and they can come in and quote the Bible and sing the songs, that they're righteous before God. But all of those things is just routine, ritual, and religion. Amen. And the problem with all of that is that it's deceived many into thinking they're righteous, but it has caused them to glory in their own selves. Amen. They walk in, they say, well, I'm probably the biggest tither at the church. I probably drive the nicest car at the church. I probably wear the best suit at the church. Lord, I'm in good standing with God. Well, let me remind you what the book of Isaiah, chapter 64, verse 6 says. It says, we are all as an unclean thing, and our righteousness is as filthy rags. Amen. I'm not ashamed to admit tonight, I'm a nothing, I'm a nobody. I ain't got nothing to offer God. I don't have a nice house. I don't have a nice car. My clothes are cheap as they can be, but I'm righteous because I have trusted in the one that come and died for me, shed his blood for me, because because He loved me. Amen. I don't have nothing else to glory in. I ain't got nothing else to brag about except the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen. Paul said this, that other people go around because they're wanting you to glory in them, but God forbid, save I glory in anything else except the cross of Jesus. Amen. I've only got one thing to shout about, and it's not because I'm a pastor of a church. It isn't because I come to a good group of people on a Sunday and a Wednesday. But the only thing I've got to boast in and brag in is the fact that I was lost, but God loved me, and He saved me and imputed His righteousness unto me. Book of Jeremiah says, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. Let not the strong man glory in his strength. But let him that glory in this, that he understand and knoweth me. Amen. See, if you walk in and you think you're doing God a favor from being at church, well, I'm afraid to tell you, you're not righteous, you're religious. Amen. If you come to church and you say, well, the reason I need to be down there is because I need God to help me, well, you're probably on the righteous path. Amen. And that's who Job's talking about tonight. Job's talking about somebody who truly loves God. That whenever they leave the church house on Sunday, that they're still thinking about God Monday through Saturday. Amen. Amen. We got a lot of people, they love to shout on Sunday, oh, how I love Jesus on Sunday. But come Monday through Saturday, they say, oh, how I wish I'd never seen Jesus. Amen. They want Jesus to see them. But that is who Job is talking about tonight. Somebody that has been saved. Somebody that's been born again. Somebody that has given their heart to God. Amen. So now let's look at what Job said, the righteous shall do. So Job is saying now that whenever somebody sees me, whenever somebody that has a relationship with God sees my affliction, they see my hurt, they see my pain, but they see that I am still going for God. You know what they need to do? It says the righteous also, listen to these few words, shall hold on his way. See, the difference between somebody that knows God and somebody that has a knowledge of God and somebody that has a true relationship with God is that whenever troubles come, they're not going to waver. Whenever hard times come, they're not going to turn back. Amen. Whenever you get to really studying who's really in it for the right reasons, who really loves God, and who's really just coming to be coming, you look at when troubles come, you look at when turmoil comes, you look whenever things don't go their way and see where they go. Amen. You see where they go. And you can tell the difference between a righteous man and a religious man. But Job says right here, somebody that's truly saved, somebody that truly loves God, somebody that has truly been born again, they shall hold on to the way they have started to begin with. Amen. They'll be singing that song within themselves, I've come too far to turn back now. Amen. I think about Jesus in the parables He gives over in the books of Matthew, in the books of Luke. He talks about these two men. He talks about a wise man and a fool. And you can almost imply right here the righteous man and the religious man. He says there was a wise man and a fool. And both of these men, they built a house. But the wise man, he dug deep and he founded his house upon a rock. And the Bible says that when the winds came, they beat vehemently upon that house. And it did not shake, but it stood where it was. Amen. And it did not fall. But the fool built his house. He built everything he had on shallow dirt. He built it on the sand. And when those winds come and beat vehemently against that house, it says that the fall of it was great and the ruin of it was great. Amen. And I believe what Jesus is applying right there is that whenever you take your life and you live by the Word of God, you stay true to God, that whenever trials come, you're not going to easily be shaken. Amen. You're going to keep your hand to the plow without looking back. We know that Jesus said over in Luke chapter number 9, He had some people come to Him one day and they said, Lord, we're going to follow You. We want to be Your disciples. They said, but first let us go back and deal with some business that we got. And Jesus said this, no man having put his hand to the plow, looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Amen. And when we can apply this to our lives today is that whenever we're going through life and trouble starts coming our way, that we're not looking back to how good we thought doubt we had it before. Amen. But we're saying God has been faithful before, and God is going to be faithful now. Amen. I believe that the reason the church has gotten so weak in the time that we're living is because now we're no longer holding true to our way. Amen. We're letting every little wind, we're letting every little storm just cause us to be disturbed and to be worried and to be burdened, that now we're no longer holding to the way that we trusted Christ with to begin with. Amen. We're following what everyone else is doing. We're going where everyone else is going. We're putting our trust in everybody else except God. But Job said right here that the righteous man shall hold on his way. That word shall means it's a fact. It's going to happen. The righteous man, when troubles come, when temptations come, when trials come, he's going to stay true to what he believes. And if you want to discern who's real in their walk with God and who's not, just let temptations come. Let the devil come tempting them to go sin, to go rebel, to go live contradictory to the word of God. You let the devil come to them and tempt them with a good time. If somebody truly loves God, somebody is truly walking, holding fast to what they believe, they're not going to be so easily pulled aside. Ain't that the truth? Ain't that the truth? The righteous, what? Shall hold. That means fasten himself to. You look up that word hold. It means they will fasten themselves to his way. His way. Well, whose way does the righteous follow? God's way. God's way. God's way. It's that simple. The righteous shall hold himself to whose way? God's way. Over in the book of Psalm chapter number 1, and Psalm 1 is one of my favorite psalms, you'll find that the psalmist writes this: blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. A righteous man, whenever things start coming off the hinges, whenever troubles start coming, whenever he starts fighting battles, he's not going to go seeking his wisdom in the world, but he's going to continue seeking his answer and his guide and his and the direction he needs to go by the word of God. Amen. See, whenever Job was having his troubles, whenever his calamity came upon him, he had his wife come and telling him in his ear, you need to curse God, you need to die, you need to give up, you need to quit, you don't need to serve him. But he said, you speak as one of the foolish women. Amen. I believe he says something like this, that God's been too good to us for me to quit serving him. Amen. But I'm afraid in our lives, whenever we go through problems, whenever things come by our way that we feel like we didn't deserve, we quit trusting in God's word and we start trusting in the counsel of the world. Amen. A righteous man will hold fast to his way even in the midst of everyone else going the way of the world. Amen. He doesn't follow the way the evil crowd's going. He doesn't follow the way that the world is going, but he stays true to God. Amen. This church would be absolutely packed tonight if all these people that come and said they love God and they profess to know the Lord, it would be packed. But you know what's happened is that troubles come, calamities come, and they have went following after the sea of the scornful. Amen. Started dealing with their troubles, started dealing with their problems with an alcohol bottle or a drug or a relationship problem. Amen. Just telling truth tonight. And the problem is because they were religious, but they were never righteous in the first place. But Job says the righteous, what? Shall hold on his way. Amen. A righteous man does not stand in the path of sinners. He doesn't put himself in a place to be tempted, doesn't put himself in a place to be torn away from the things of God, because a righteous man shall hold on to his way. Amen. Psalm number 1 says that the one that walks in the counsel of the Lord, one that walks righteously, he shall be planted like a tree by rivers of water and bringeth forth fruit in his season. You know how he brings forth fruit? Because he stays planted in the way that he has begun. Amen. And I'm afraid tonight that so many people have come in with the form of godliness, denied the power thereof, and they're no longer holding on to the old past, but they're going the crooked way, going the way of the world. Amen. 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 The righteous shall hold on his way. I think about other people in the Bible, and I think about stories, and there's many people we could go. There's many people we could go through, and we talk about how they held their ways in time of trouble. I mean, we're looking at Job right here. Job went through any affliction that no man has ever went through before. Lost all his camels, lost all his donkeys, lost everything, lost his substance, lost everything. The greatest man of the East was now sitting in a pile of ashes, scraping himself with broken glass. I mean, this man was pitiful, but he stayed true to God. Amen. Abraham, we know, the friend of God. We know he was one that got called 75 years old to go out and walk with God, but whenever time started getting hard and the famine got in the land, what did he do? He ran down to Egypt. Y'all remember that? Remember that? But he seen he messed up, and what did he do? Returned back to the land of Canaan, and what did he do? Built an altar unto the Lord, and he repented. Amen. That's what we ought to do. Amen. There's going to be times it may feel like we lose our way, but whenever we see we lost our way, you know what we need to do? Come back to where we messed up and make it right with God. Amen. But one of the greatest examples in the Word of God of somebody that was righteous that never lost their way was Joseph in the Old Testament. We know Jacob, we know Abraham had Isaac, had Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, and we know that Joseph was the favorite son. He had the coat of many colors, and his brothers despised him. His brothers hated him because he was favored by the father. We know how Joseph one day was wearing that coat, and his brothers had put up a plan that they were going to kill their brother. But thank God for Reuben, who said, no, we're not going to kill him, but we're just going to cast him into this pit right here. Amen. Going to cast him in this pit. They stripped him of his cloak. They threw him down in that pit. He was laying in there, and then that Egyptian band came by, and they sold their brother into slavery. But you want to know what the Bible says about that? God was with him. God was with him. Amen. That's all that matters. Amen. In the pit, in the prison, in the palace, God is with you. You just remember that. That's a quick little sermon right there. Amen. No matter where you're at, God was with him. But you'll never find one time throughout Joseph, I mean, there's 10 or 11 chapters throughout the book of Genesis, you'll never find one time Joseph wavering his way with God. He never cursed God for being betrayed by his brothers. He went down into Egypt, and Pharaoh's wife really liked Joseph. She wanted to have intercourse with him. She tried to bring herself upon him, but Joseph said, no, this ain't right. He said, no. He said, no. He said, no. He was tempted. He was tried. The devil came at him, tried to ruin his testimony. But the man, the righteous man, what did he do? He held on to his way. Amen. Now, I'm afraid so many of us, we go through temptation. The devil comes knocking at our door, and we don't hold on to our way. We just let go to go have a few minutes of fun, and it ruins our life. Amen. But you know what Joseph did? He held on to his way. Whenever he went, he was put in prison. You know what the Bible says? God was with him. Amen. He could have went and could have cursed God and said, I've been living faithful. I've been living right. I've been doing everything I need to do, but he didn't do that. You know what he did? He held on to his way. Whenever he was exalted to power after he interpreted Pharaoh's dreams and everybody, and he was exalted up the power, and he had people under him, and he was the second greatest man in Egypt, you know what he did? He still held on to his way. See, a lot of people, whenever they get power, whenever they get a big head, whenever they get a name, you know what they do? They quit relying on God, start relying on themselves. Ain't that the truth? Amen. Whenever they go through, whenever they win enough battles, they think on their own, they say, you know what, God? I don't need you no more. And they quit holding on to the way that God demanded them to start. They find themselves in trouble. Amen. But Job said right here that the righteous man shall hold upon his way tonight. Amen. And my prayer for you, my prayer for myself, is that no matter if afflictions come, no matter if trials come, testing, temptations come, that we don't waver in what we believe in our heart. Amen. The reason we don't need to, you listen to all these babies in the house of God tonight. We got a generation coming up behind us. They need to see the real way. They need to see the true way. Amen. They need to see that mama and daddy wasn't no hypocrite. They wasn't no ankle-deep Christian. That whenever they didn't get their way, whenever they thought God wouldn't bless them, they got out of church, amen, but even when they were struggling, even when they were tried, even when they were put in the furnace, they stayed faithful to God, and they never lost their way, amen. I say this all the time. I've told people like this, that one day my kid, he may raise up, and he may see that his daddy didn't have a lot of money, his daddy didn't have great possessions, his daddy didn't have a lot of accolades, but there's one thing his daddy had, and that was Jesus living in his heart, and if it was enough for daddy, it'll be enough for him too. Amen. Amen. My prayer tonight is that no matter what we go through, the righteous will hold on to his way. But now let's look at also what Job says here. Job says the righteous shall hold on his way. Now listen to what Job says. He says, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. Amen. So Job right there, the first part of that verse, he made a very doctrinal statement that the righteous shall hold on his way. But how can a righteous man hold on to his way? How can a righteous man, how can somebody that loves God, how can somebody that wants to stay true to God, stay true to God? He answers that in the second part of this verse. Amen. In this proverb right here. He says, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. Amen. I like that because there's a promise in there. There's a promise in there. Many times throughout your Bible, you will find that expression, clean hands. You'll find the expression, wash your hands. You'll find that God demanded people to clean their hands. And one of the most interesting points, and one of the ones that stand out the most, is whenever Moses and the children of Israel had been over in the wilderness, circling around Mount Sinai, and God had brought Moses up onto the mountain and was giving him the law. And while he was giving him the law, he also gave him the plans for the tabernacle and everything that was going to be in it. And in the tabernacle, that'd be a good study for us to do sometime, because, man, that's some good stuff over in there when you start reading about that stuff. But God told Moses, he said, this is what I want you to put in the tabernacle. I want you to put a laver of brass. And what it just turned out to be is just a big sink. Just a big sink. He says, so I want you to put a sink in the tabernacle. You're going to put it between the court of the congregation of the tabernacle, and you're going to put it between there, between the court, and you're going to put it between the court and where the altar, where the burnt offerings is going to be. That's what he told him. So before you from where everyone gathered to where the altar would be, that people would burn, that Aaron and his sons would burn offerings up to God and make an atonement for sins and everything like that, it says they had to stop at that laver and clean their hands and clean their feet. Before they could come into the presence of God, they had to clean their hands and clean their feet. And you want to know why? Because God doesn't like uncleanliness. And God is a God that demands purity, demands holiness. He demands cleanliness. Amen. And whenever God was going to have a sacrifice be brought to him, it had to be clean, but also the person bringing it had to be clean as well. Amen. And the only way that they could receive anything from God is that they had to clean their hands. Amen. And you'll study, if you go on through the book of Exodus and study that, whenever Moses come down off that mountain and started preparing that tabernacle in the wilderness and setting up everything, getting the ark built and getting the mercy seat prepared, everything, the last thing he did before he set up the gates, it says that he went to that laver where God had commanded him. He washed his hands. He washed his feet. Washed himself with all. Completely covered himself. Like an Old Testament form of baptism. And it says whenever he done that and set up the court gates, it says then the glory of the Lord appeared unto the congregation there. Amen. Before God's presence could dwell, before God could come down and strengthen them, before God could come down and abide with them, there had to be cleanliness. Amen. And right here, Job says, he that cleans his hands shall be stronger and stronger. If you want help in order to hold your way in the hour of testing and the time of trial and the time of trouble and tribulation, you know what it's going to take from doing? Cleaning your hands. It's going to take by getting stronger in the Lord and not yourself. Amen. See, the problem with so many people is they're trying to hold up. Man, I thank you, Jolene. You came tonight for a perfect time. Amen. Right. Amen. Amen. They're going through life and they're trying to fight battles like this. But you want to know what they're doing? They're trying to do it on their own. They're trying to do it in their own way, in their own form, in their own fashion. And before you know it, they get weaker and weaker and weaker and can't hold on to it. You know why? Because there's sin in their life. Because there's things in their life that does not need to be there. Amen. For the past 2 or 3 years, all you have heard is to wash your hands. Wash your hands. Wash your hands so you don't get sick. Wash your hands so your kids don't get sick. Clean everything. Disinfect this. Disinfect that. Oh, clean your hands. Why? Because if we don't clean our hands, there's going to be something that makes us sick and infects our life. And God knows that if we're trying to be strong in Him and stay on the right way, you know what it's going to take? Having things removed out of our life to draw closer to Him. Amen. It's that simple right there. And there's a promise in there. There's a promise in there. It says, he that cleans his hands, what does it say? Shall be stronger and stronger. It's because whenever you clean up your life, whenever you clean things out of your life, you clean sin and things that does not need to be there. You know what that does? It ushers in the presence of God in your life. If you feel like it, you can turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter number 24. Book of Psalms, chapter number 24 says this. Amen. I got Bible for this. It says this, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Talking about who shall ascend into the presence of God. Or who shall stand in His holy place? Who can come into the presence of God? Listen, Psalm 24, verse 4. He that hath clean hands and a pure heart. That's simple right there. He that hath clean hands and a pure heart. He that has taken sin in his life, he that has taken iniquity and transgression and has washed himself of it, put it away off himself, he is the one that is in the presence of God. And whenever you're in the presence of God, you want to know what it does to you? It makes you stronger and stronger. longer. Amen. It's that simple. James chapter number 4. If somebody wants to turn there tonight, one of the best things in the Word of God. James chapter number 4, verse number 8, one of the most well-known verses. It says, draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. There's a promise right there in the Word of God. But that's not all there is to that verse. See, if you're looking for something to help you hold on to your way with God, if you're looking for something to help you stay true to God, it takes this. Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. But see, that's not the end of that verse. It says, cleanse your hands, ye sinners. That's hard, ain't it? You want to get closer to God. You want God to help you on your walk. You want God to help you in your troubles. You want God to help you when you go through trials. There's only one way to do it. You can draw nigh to God. He'll draw nigh to you, but there's a way you got to do it. You got to cleanse your hands. You got to wipe some things off that you don't need to be carrying. And it says, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. It's that simple tonight. Amen. Job said that the righteous man shall hold on to his way, and he can, amen, and we should, amen. No matter what we go through, no matter what we face, no matter what kind of storms or troubles, no matter what temptation, we ought to be holding true to what we believe. But how can we do that? By removing things in our life that does not need to be there, amen. Is there a sin in your life that's hindering you from drawing closer to God? We all got one that's trying to easily beset us, amen. We got things that we think all the time that easily beset us. You want to know one of the most infecting sins that keeps a lot of people? It ain't that they're bad people or unmorally good people, all this stuff, but you want to know the one that we need to cleanse off our hands? Unbelief. We come to a storm, we come through a trouble, whenever we start facing things that it feels like God ain't going to be there to help us, we can't get through it on our own, we lose our way. You want to know why? Because we ain't cleaned our hands of the unbelief of this world, amen. That's one thing we need to cleanse off. But the Bible says that he that cleans his hands of things that is not that does not need to be there, he shall be stronger and stronger, amen. I don't know about you, but I need all the strength I can get. Amen. I need all the help I can get. Amen. I need more of God today than I did yesterday. And whenever you clean off your hands, whenever you stay true to Him, amen, we get more peace in our life. Amen. We get more assurance over situations that everything is going to be all right. That the same God that was with Joshua, the same God that saved Peter from sinking, the same God that healed blind Bartimaeus, is the same God living in us. And how does that come? From cleansing yourself of sin, and you will be strong. Stronger and stronger. Amen. You'll get more joy. You'll get more strength. You'll get more light. You'll get more boldness. Get more faith. And you'll get more blessings from it. Amen. Because God will bless those that stay true to Him. Amen. God will be faithful to those that stay faithful to Him. And I think we just need to take Job's proverb tonight and apply it to our life. That the righteous also shall hold on his way. And how shall he do that? By cleaning his hands. Because he'll be stronger and stronger. Amen. Amen. God's good tonight, isn't He? God is good tonight. And I pray it's something that maybe something you learn, something you apply to your life, that no matter what we go through, we need to hold true to God. We need to remain fastened to the way we began in. Amen. It's too late to turn back now. Too late to throw in the towel now. Amen. I'm afraid we're seeing a lot, and this has happened in a lot of places, that people that served God for 40, 50, 60 years are dipping their colors now. They're getting out of it now, right here at the end, whenever there's generations coming up that need to see that they hold fast to the true way, the old path, the good way, sound doctrine, the King James. I mean, all these things we need to hold true to this way. Amen. No matter what everyone else is saying, no matter where everyone else is going, no matter what people say, we need to hold true to that way, and we need to just clean our hands day in and day out, and we shall be stronger and stronger. Amen. God bless you for coming tonight. Prayer is a blessing. Prayer is a help. And God bless y'all going home. Be safe until the next appointed time. I hope you stay safe, healthy, and happy. And God bless you tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, I love you, Lord. I just thank you, Lord, for the Word of God. Lord, I just pray tonight, Lord, that each and everybody that come into this church tonight, Lord, will hold true to their way. And Lord, I pray, Lord, they would see that, Lord, in order to do that, God, they need to remove things out of their life, that, God, they need to clean their hands, Lord, of any filthiness, Lord, of any sin, of any unbelief, of anything, God, that could cause them to grow weaker. And Lord, they would clean their hands to become stronger and stronger and stronger for you. Lord, just be with us as we go out. And Lord, just keep us all healthy until the next appointed time, God. May we just be a light to shine in someone's dark world. Lord, we love you. God, we praise you. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.